This is John Keane on Radio VPRO.
1969, was it?
Pardon?
1969, was it something in the year?
Yeah, 1969.
Yeah, really big hit.
Yeah, it's very big. 9 countries, number one.
Uh-huh. In 9 landen, number 1. But the only one as yet.
Yeah.
Tot nu toe geen andere.
I'll cry about that.
Welcome in the studio, John. First, I have to explain something about your career to the listeners. You don't care?
No.
You don't mind?
No, I don't mind.
John Keane heeft in 1967 een liedje geschreven voor The Who. Dat liedje werd uitgevoerd op de LP The Who Sell Out, die in 1967 verscheen. Hij was voornamelijk liedjeschrijver tot het moment dat Pete Townshend van The Who op het idee kwam om een nieuwe groep samen te stellen uit 3 zeer uiteenlopende heren. De liedjeschrijver John Keane, die nu naast me zit, Andy Newman, een zeer vreemdsoortige boogie-pianist. That's right, John, Andy Newman is a boogie-pianist, or how would you describe that?
Boogie-pianist is perfect.
Yeah, is that okay to you?
Yeah. He's a 1930s boogie-pianist.
30-jarige stijl dus. En verder was daar Jimmy McCullough, die in die tijd 15 jaar was. En heel hard op een gitaar speelde. Quite a strange band, wasn't it?
Very strange at the time. Not many people understood it, you know.
How did it work? You went on a tour after you had the hit Something in the Air. You went on a tour in England.
Yeah, we were forced to go on a tour, really, because of the success of the records, you know. But, you know, the tour really was, you know, the killer in it, because it was put together on a very loose, friendly social level, and to suddenly have the pressure of backing up a single really was very difficult at the beginning, you know. After about 7 months of hard playing and every club and every gig that ever had a band playing it, it got really, you know, kind of nice then, though, you know. Mm. But it was very hard work at first. It was very hard work when you were kind of going on the stage, on the stage, right? Or you'd play a gig and it'd be like the electric jack plugs, right? With
the electric what?
Jack plugs, right? With 30,000 watts, you know what I mean? You know, followed by the, you know what I mean, the inflamed ear rolls, you know, with 50,000 watts, and followed by sort of like the golden spark plugs with 100,000 watts, and then Thunderclap Newman, right, with like a 7-foot contrabass saxophone and a 30-watt amplifier.
Yeah, let me translate this, at least try.
Okay, you know.
Thunderclap Newman had dus die hit in 69 met Something in the Air. En als je een hit hebt, zowel in Nederland, in de popmuziek als in Engeland, dan moet je daar onmiddellijk geld aan gaan verdienen, want de mensen kennen dat liedje van de radio. En ze hebben die single gekocht en ze willen die band dan ook wel eens een keer live zien. En dan moet je heel vlug wezen. You have to be quick to cash in if you have a hit.
Yeah, well, you get pressure from your record company.
En de platenmaatschappij zit er ook stevig achterheen. Maar toen hij zeer enthousiaste, maar niet zo erg perfecte tournee, want die groep was helemaal niet berekend om op tournee te gaan in Engeland. Well, the band wasn't really fit to go on tour.
Not really, no. It was put together on a much warmer level than, you know, like if you're 4 guys and you think you've really got something to offer, you going on the road is the fulfillment of what you've rehearsed and what you've got together. If we'd have made albums, it would have been perfect for us because we had that balance. We had to compensate. We had to be compatible to each other, you know, because Andy would only play boogie. He would play nothing else. So I had to write the songs in such a way that I could get my song across, but also lean as space for him in the song, which contributed as well.
Yeah.
Just us and him, us and him. You know?
Het was natuurlijk een ontzettend probleem om die groep ingespeeld te krijgen, want die 15-jarige gitarist uit Schotland was daar en de boogie-pianist die eruit zag alsof hij 50 was, maar in werkelijkheid was hij maar 30 jaar. En hij had een wit pak aan en hij wist echt niet van popmuziek. You didn't know about rock and roll, Andy Newman.
The player.
So this was quite a job to do.
Yeah, it just meant that you had to swallow all the things you'd learned. In other words, you know, forget all your sort of rock and roll career and take it from that point. In other words, the speed that he would play your song at would be the way you did it. You know?
Mm-hmm. Het tempo wat de pianist aanhield, dat moest de rest dan maar volgen. Het was dus echt een liefhebbersgroep die min of meer overrompeld werd door die fantastische hit. And then you had an album called Hollywood Dream and produced by Pete Townshend.
Yes.
And he also played bass on it, and I still think it's a fantastic album.
Yes, so do I.
Yeah.
I think it's an incredible album.
And I'd like you to talk a bit about one very long number called Accidents. It is een nummer wat gaat over ongelukken die aan kleine kinderen overkomen. Het duurt 8 minuten. En ik ga John Keane vragen wat nou precies de intentie achter dat nummer is. Is it really kind of a sick song, or well, how would you explain it to the listeners?
Well, but you'll have to translate it.
Ik mag het uitleggen.
It was one of the very early songs I did. You know, I used to drive a truck. You know,
Hij was vrachtwagenchauffeur.
And you know, I used to sort of like get these incredible emotional upsurges, you know. I'm trying to explain that.
Emotional upsurges. Yeah. Okay, let's leave that.
And you know, I just sort of like that's how Accidents come about. I wanted it to be a surrealistic song. In it's like a child care song in a way. I mean, that sounds very silly, but it was that sort of flash. You know what I mean? I just sort of suddenly, as I was driving down the road, would see these sort of like 4-year-old kids just marching around. You know,
yeah.
And that's what sprang it up. But basically, it was supposed to have been a surrealistic song. In other words, the kids equally could have been killed in all the instances described in the song, or they could equally have gone home. But the onus was on us to make sure they don't get killed. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah,
it was very sincerely meant.
Oh, okay. Het liedje is dus geschreven achter het stuur van een vrachtwagen. En John vertelt dat hij voortdurend in situaties kwam als vrachtrijder waarin kinderen nog maar net levend aan de overkant van de straat kwamen. En hij begon zich te realiseren dat het dus echt aan de chauffeurs. Het is de zaak van de chauffeurs om te zien dat het niet gebeurt. En well, anything else to explain about Accidents?
Well, basically, the track that's on the Hollywood Dream album is the first part is their accidents, right? Their description of their accidents. And the second part is them presumably going to heaven, which Andy did, right? And that's his part, and that's their journey to wherever they go, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the last part is the fulfillment of the total song, the meaning of what we were trying to portray in that particular song. And I like that, the accumulation of, like, it's like breaking the sound barrier, you know, that's the effect we try to make, you know, going from one extreme to another, really, you know.
Yeah, I see.
Which it does do, and as soon as Andy begins, you don't forget the song that's come before. It, for some reason it worked incredibly like that with him. You wouldn't, because normally if somebody starts playing piano like that,
yeah,
under normal circumstances you forget the song that's gone down before, you know, or what's happened previous to it, you know. But he had that sort of quality of playing things which, though they didn't fit in rock and roll terms, they fitted in sense terms.
In your songs, at least.
Yeah, very much. Yeah.
Wel, het lied gaat als volgt. Het eerste gedeelte behandelt de ongelukken. Daarna gaan de kinderen naar de hemel. En wat daarna komt, dat is zo'n beetje de conclusie van John.